evening. You're watching the India Development Debate. I'm Tamanna Inamdar. With the Maharashtra political crisis now coming to end, it's time to focus on the economy, and that's exactly what happened in Parliament today. The Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman mounted a spirited defense on the state of the economy, saying that though growth may have slowed down, India is definitely not in a recession. She was replying to opposition leaders who attacked the Modi government's record on the economic slowdown. Let's start by listening into excerpts of that debate which took place in Parliament today.
Growth may have come down, but it's not a recession yet, or it won't be a recession ever. 2,50,000 crores have been distributed through the public sector banks. How was that possible if we didn't give them liquidity? So, sir, please, recapitalization had a reason and that paid off. And that paid off. The reform steps also resulted in the merger of 10 public sector banks into 4 entities. States and the compensation matter was not addressed by the UPA MAT, which is seen even today as a very, very regressive tax. Again, dividend distribution tax, which even today is on, there's a lot of argument which says it's very, very regressive.
आर्थिक प्रगति ठहर सी गई है, देश की जीडीपी निरंतर गिरती जा रही है, कारखाने बंद हो रहे हैं, रोजगार टूट रहा है, मांग टूट रही है, बाजार टूट रहे हैं, लोगों के पास पैसा नहीं है आम जरूरत की और आवश्यक चीजें खरीदने के लिए. गांव में स्थिति और भी गंभीर है. देश का कृषि क्षेत्र गहरे संकट से गुजर रहा है और भारत का किसान त्राही त्राही कर रहा है. अमीर और गरीब के बीच में खाई बढ़ती जा रही है. द जीडीपी ऑफ द कंट्री हैज फॉलन टू 5%, सर, which is the lowest in the last 7 years.
Why is industry so unsure? Why are people unsure? And sir, my hypothesis today is based on a 5-letter word, trust. Because to trust somebody, you have to rely on them. They have to have ability. They have to have integrity. Hasty GST, we supported you with GST. We warned you about implementation. Now what has happened? Trader segment, 43% down. Micro segment, 32% down. 35% down in the small business and 24% in the medium business.
Well, interestingly, Nirmala Sitharaman's defense of the economy and her government's handling of the economy comes just 2-3 days before India will put out its growth numbers for the second quarter, expected this Friday, in fact. And 18 hours learning, this may be close to 4%, a number even lower than the 5% GDP growth that we saw in Q1. So tonight on The Big Debate, we look at the arguments that the finance minister has put forward in Parliament. How acceptable are they? Speaking to me on this today are Madan Sabnavis, Chief Economist Care Ratings, Pooja Mehra, author and journalist. Gopal Krishna Agarwal, National Spokesperson of the BJP, joins us today as well. And I'm also speaking with Maithili Bhusnamath, Consulting Editor, ET Now. Welcome to all of you and thank you for talking to us today. Pooja, let me start with you. And, your take. The fact is that the finance minister took her time and detailed out a response to most of the charges made. She talked about 32 steps of reforms that have taken place and said that they will show effect. I don't think Pooja can hear me.
I've lost the audio.
Can you hear me, Pooja? No, I don't think she can hear me. We'll get her audio back. But meanwhile, let me go across to Maithili Bhusnamath with that question. Maithili, what did you make of Nirmala Sitharaman's spirited defense today?
Well, it was a very spirited defense. And the fact is that she is right when she says that the BJP inherited an economy in a pretty bad shape from the Congress. But the fact is also true that the government was in denial for much after the slowdown became very evident. And even though the government did take a number of steps, I think they faltered on two major grounds. Recapitalization of banks took place much too late and much too little. It was in dips and drabs. demonetization was a policy which the government clearly pursued for political ends. And though there might be some return in terms of long-term reward, in terms of formalization in the economy, the fact is that we paid a very big economic cost, and it's not very clear that the economic cost was worth the price that we actually paid, the rewards were worth the price that we paid. So government clearly has something to answer for as well. And I think here the government, this adherence to the fiscal deficit target, that 3%, 3.3%, they seem so hung up on. That, I think, is one of the biggest failings of the government, because at a time when private investment is not picking up, the ball was clearly in the government's court. Yes, it has undertaken a number of reforms, but these have not yet paid fruit. So I think the government needs to take the bull by the horns, forget its fixation with the fiscal deficit number of 3.3%, and start spending on those sectors where you can will get more bang for the buck, particularly construction, railways, roadways. These are the kind of areas where there would be immediate impact, rather than giving tax giveaways to the corporate sector, which are really not going to benefit the economy, at least in the short run. So I think the government also must answer for the fact that it took these measures, remedial measures, much too late and much too little. So yes, there is something to be said for the government having inherited an economy in poor shape, but the government also did not rise up to the challenge sufficiently early.
Across to Gopal Agarwal. Gopal Agarwal, the finance minister's response was obviously, of course, a political one as well, because she was responding to charges raised by opposition MPs on the floor of the House, and which is why perhaps she kept referring to, you know, look at what you did in your term. But beyond the political rhetoric, all of us are interested in knowing what is being done, and is enough being done? Is there a sense of denial, or is there a lack of understanding of the extent of trouble we're in? We're, you know, a couple of days away from GDP figures, which could be as low as 4%.
Tamanna, nobody is denying that there is a slowness in the growth of, in the economy. It was above 7%, and now it is around 5.6 or 6%, around that ratio. And it has come down. That's the government is not denying that. But when you call this slow reduction in growth rate as recession, that's what we are objecting to. Recession means a negative growth, and everybody accepts. Now, and at any point of time in the economy, there are challenges everywhere across the globe. Even if American economy is doing good, there are several challenges. China has challenges. Similarly, India has certain challenges. There are sectors which are facing problems. The government is well averse with it, and the important thing is that when we are talking about reforms that we took is on the supply side of credit.
Right.
Credit was a big problem, banking, financial institutions,
corruption, etc. No, it is still a big problem, Gopalji. It is still a big problem.
The tax collection.
It is still a big problem, and recession is a term. Recession
yes.
is a term. We're not in recession, and thank God, and hopefully we never will be. But that's not the only question, is it? Whether we're in a recession or not. We want to get out of the slowdown.
Yeah, but no. Yes, what is the government ready to act? I am telling you, finance minister herself has said that at more than 30 times different changes even after budget have taken place. So we are working on an economic ecosystem where it is transparent, corruption free, level playing field, giving equal opportunity. Earlier, when we are talking about heritage or inheritance problem, that is because we never said ki growth in last 65 years, there was no growth. But the growth happened with concentration of wealth. There was a limited number of people who were benefiting. Now, we have set up a target of $5 trillion economy. There are challenges,
yes,
whether in the automobile,
no,
whether
wealth,
in the power sector,
concentration of
real
wealth
estate
still
sector.
Continues.
But
concentration of wealth still. I just want to get in a quick word from Madan Sabnavis. Concentration of wealth still continues.
No, but
the question is not the question.
But we
is
are
not,
working on the solutions.
Yes,
and
but is
cleaning
the solution,
up the systems.
Is the are the solutions working? Is a question that will be asked from time to time. Whether it's in parliament or in news
so
studios
or by people
who go out to vote. 1 minute. Let me just get a quick word in from Madan Sabnavis. On his take. And you know, Madan, of course, I'm talking to you at a time, and ET Now has learned today that we could see a Q2 figure at 4%. Various agencies have predicted between 4.2 to 4.8 for Q2. let me come to you, and I know you would not want to answer a political question, so let me ask you a policy-driven question on your view on the steps taken so far and what's needed further.
No, actually, if you look at the steps which the government has taken, I think they have been very, very appropriate, and they have been targeted towards specific problems which are there. But a problem with these measures is that they're going to work over a period of time, and I think it'll take at least 1 to 2 years before they're able to deliver results, because they've looked at the various problem spots which are there in the economy, and accordingly have had certain announcements made. But as what Maithili was saying, I think that's very, very pertinent. If you don't put money on the table, I don't think we'll be able to get out of this low phase growth which we have here. See, it's a matter of semantics where we keep saying that it's a recession or not, but the fact remains that consumption is down, investment is stagnant, government is not willing to compromise on a fiscal deficit. So I think there has to be somebody who has to give in out here. We've already seen that the Reserve Bank of India has lowered the rates to abnormal levels downwards. Yet we don't see people borrowing money. They're going to borrow money unless there are opportunities. So therefore, I think unless the government is in a position to spend more money, they will have to say that we're going to spend 1% of GDP extra in the form of higher fiscal deficit. Only then can we see something happening in the immediate run. And I don't see that happening in the current financial year. So I think it's going to be low growth for one more year. Q2 will, of course, be around 4.5%, yeah, or maybe even lower. The entire year may go maybe even around 5-5.5%. But we definitely will take some time before we get back to the 7% range.
Well, we hope we get back sooner than later. But, you know, unfortunately, the reams of data coming in is quite dismal. I've got Pooja Mehra back with me. Pooja, hopefully you can hear me. And let me get your, you know, sort of opening comment on a very important subject. The finance minister standing and explaining what is being done on the floor of the house. And she's mentioning her steps, 32 steps taken since the last budget. She's telling the opposition that, you know, look at the legacy you have left and what you have done. All of that is very well in the political arena. But the key question is that is the government seized of the situation? We're staring possibly at a 4% growth in Q2.
If the government is seized of the situation, then the finance minister's speech in parliament today did not adequately reflect that. Perhaps it is a case of her not wanting to completely concede that the economy is not in great shape right now. Nevertheless, I feel that, you know, given the state the economy is in, it would have been better for her to take the topic up front, to say that yes, there is a problem and this is what I plan to do further. Because the 30, whatever number of steps she has taken so far, most of them are good steps, but they have not helped and they will not help yet because the economy needs a lot more to be done. Also, I thought, you know, the manner in which she gave data, especially for tax collections, that's more a case of presenting data in a way where the presentation is intended to show that performance is not bad, but you know the performance data, tax collections are not doing well, I'm afraid. Yeah. For 3 months in a row, GST collections have remained below 1 lakh crore. States are saying that 14% growth of GST collections, which is a short to them, at the time of shifting to GST is not taking place. In fact, their compensations are not that are promised to them under the constitutional amendment are not being made in time. The finance ministry has, I know from my sources in the finance commission, the finance ministry has informed the finance commission that they expect a 2 lakh crore revenue shortfall relative to the budget estimates that were laid down in July. So I'm not sure, you know, how does it help to, you know, present data selectively, you know, take absolute numbers, not show that how the percentage growth of direct tax collections is now slower than even the nominal GDP growth. Right. And these are nominal numbers. Tax collections are nominal numbers. The message that I get from all of it is that the government is still not willing to say that, yes, this is a significant problem and this is what we're going to do in the future. In fact, I was hoping to, you know, get some sense from the finance minister on what her understanding of the problem is. There is a lot of debate in the public discourse on whether this is a demand-driven slowdown or a supply side slowdown, whether fiscal measures are required or monetary measures. She did not throw light on any of that part of the thinking in the government. We don't know what the strategy or the understanding of the government of the economic situation is. And I thought today was the right platform and the right time for her to at least put that out. So I'm a little disappointed. I think she's taken some good steps. I think she needs to take more steps. But today's address, I'm a little disappointed.
Gopal Agarwal, you want to come in on that? And that's a pertinent point Pooja makes, because I understand the political rhetoric and the compulsion of it all. You know, your opposition party say you're not doing enough. You say, like, look at what you did. At least I have done this. All of that is fine. But when you're hearing the finance minister speak, you're hoping to get a deeper understanding of what the finance minister's take is on what's going on right now. There are a lot of theories out there. But what is the government view?
Tamanna, when I don't accept Pooja ji's viewpoint here, because if the government is not appraised of the problems and what is the solution, why 32 steps will have been taken after the budget? That be every problem. Even finance minister said in her budget speech that more reforms or more response to the crisis or the problems we are not ruling out. So budget exercise is now being done. What who is saying that we don't understand the problems? When we are talking of macroeconomic parameters, government is saying that most of them are under control, are in good shape. But with regard to microeconomic, like consumer behavior, producers behavior, there are problems. Government has accepted. Therefore, we are working on PM Kisan Yojana, which is a successful way of putting money into the farmers' hand so that they have a buyer purchasing power. Consumer demand is an important challenge that we are facing.
Yeah,
we
but have what to are you going to do
the
about
consumer
it?
Demand
Gopal Agarwal, consumer demand is an important challenge we are facing.
So
the
corporate
now says it's at all-time lows, but we've known for a while that people are not going out and spending. So we've been theorizing, everyone's been theorizing, is it because they have money but they don't have trust, or they don't
that's
have
because,
money?
Because Tamanna.
But what are we doing about it?
I went to
can
a
I respond?
Today.
Can I respond to
yeah.
that?
So I told you PM Kisan Yojana, we are putting up.
I'd like to respond to that.
Yeah, just a minute.
We are putting money into the hand of the rural factor. No, let me finish. Second thing is corporate tax has been reduced. We are creating liquidity and credit line to the NBFC, even micro, medium, small industries are being given credit through loan melas. So liquidity is being created, infrastructure spending, government has not reduced, working on more infrastructure spending, even to protect domestic industry.
No, but state
some
governments are reducing infrastructure spending.
Like RCEP,
it's not just central government. State governments are reducing infrastructure spending. They're saying, GST ka paisa nahi mila hai. So, you know, that's what I'm saying. Efforts are there, but are they in the... Okay, let Pooja quickly respond to the point you were making.
Tamanna.
Just one minute, sir. Let's get more views in.
Yeah, the points that I wanted to...
We are not saying...
Let Pooja respond and then I'll ask Maithili to come in. Yes, Pooja.
Yeah, what I wanted to say is that I don't think it is a micro problem when we talk about consumer behavior. The economy is facing an aggregate demand problem. That is a the economy is currently facing an aggregate demand problem, and I wouldn't categorize like Mr. Gopal does, categorize it as a micro problem. And therefore, that's why I said that, you know, the government needs to put on the table what its diagnosis of the aggregate demand problem is, what its diagnosis of the savings, aggregate savings problem in the economy is. Piecemeal measures by themselves are all right, but are they adding up to what the economy needs or not is what we want to assess, and the only way to assess that is to know what part of the problem is the government trying to attack, what is going to be the sequence of reforms. I don't know how it helps. Even the economic survey made the point of about policy certainty, how keeping things undercover right now or not, you know, giving out a roadmap of steps to be taken in the next few weeks. I'm not sure how that's helping the situation. I thought today was the right day to put that out.
Yeah, you made that point. You made that point. Yes, Maithili.
One minute, Gopal.
Let everyone
to repeat what I said earlier.
We'll
that in fairness
time.
To the
Don't
government,
worry. We have ample 32%. Time. Yes, Maithili.
Uh,
I wanted to repeat what I was saying earlier. My words were drowned under the cacophony of comments from everybody else, was that it is not that the slowdown is unique to India. Growth has slowed down across the world, including in China, including the US, which is actually doing very well till fairly recently. So the slowdown is across the world. Having said that, the fact is that there is a limit to which consumption can drive the economy. Ultimately, the multiplier from investment spending, from capital expenditure, is much higher than from consumption spending. And this is where the ball is clearly in the government's court, because when private investment is not picking up, it is for the government to spend, and to spend on the right things where the multiplier effect is the maximum. So this is where the role of the government in things on spending on areas like road building, on building of bridges, those are the kind of areas where the government could spend. And though they have announced 100 lakh crore spending on infrastructure, that is yet to begin. Yeah. So I think the government must become a little brave, and though tax revenues have not been doing well, there is enormous scope in terms of greater aggressive disinvestment. Yes. So there is money, and the government must use that money, disinvestment quickly, do strategic disinvestment that they've already announced, get that money and use it to spend on investment. And that could give you much more bang for the buck than any kind of corporate tax cuts, because that will not have an immediate impact on growth.
So, SCI Concord already today, the aviation minister talking about privatization of Air India, saying if it's not privatized, we'll shut it down. So, a bit more on that story ahead on the show as well. Gopal Agarwal wants to come back, but before that, I just want to play out, some parts of what the finance minister said today, and quite a fiery speech. In this particular one, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman was taking on the opposition for their criticism of her corporate tax cut.
A government which many of us do recall in 91, and even very many of us do refer to the reformative steps taken by Dr. Manmohan Singh at that time. Globalization, opening up of the economy, more reforms. And in fact, between 2014 and 19, we were constantly questioned, where are your reforms? This time too, where are your reforms? Take lessons from Dr. Manmohan Singh. Surely, sir. Surely, why not? But they are the ones who are now condemning corporate tax reduction, saying suit boot ke sarkar ko de rahi ho. Globalization karne wale kaun hai sir? Kaun open kiya economy ko? Kyun kiya? Wo tab theek hai, ab ye theek nahi hai.
Fiery speech over there, Madan Sabnavis. I want to talk about the point. I'm going to take the point. You know, Madan Sabnavis is worried about what I'm going to ask him. I'm going to take on the point about opening up the economy. Point about opening up the economy. Are we opening up the economy at a time when, you know, we've stayed out of RCEP right now? We seem to be putting up more trade barriers than ever before. And of course, that's something that's happening around the world. How do you see that in the context of how India is trying to push forward?
No, actually, if you look at our overall foreign policy or everything related to the foreign sector, I think it's fairly ambivalent. Where we are very quite open when it comes to FPI and FDI. So in terms of capital inflows, I think we are fairly open. We want more of those funds to come in. But whenever it comes to a kind of a choice of saying that if I want to join the RCEP or anything to do with globalization, global trade, we also turn slightly protectionist because there's another constituency to also protect. And I don't think there's anything right or wrong about it, but definitely this kind of an ambivalent stance actually means that we'll not be really be able to leverage the gains from globalization, something which lots of other countries have done. So I won't say that there's nothing right or wrong out here, but definitely in terms of trade, I don't think we have that kind of advantage. But in terms of investment, I think we have made very good progress out there.
Yes, Gopal Agarwal, do come in. Gopal Agarwal, do come in. Corporate tax cut hailed by all. But two things.
Yeah.
How many companies are actually going to implement it and give up their, you know, concessions which they were getting instead? And even when they do, how many of them are sort of going to pass that on in terms of more investments?
Definitely, Tamanna, the investment is a play of demand in the economy. So yeah, the basic problem is that we have to create demand so that investment will be attracted for that. So, this is one issue. I just want to mention two points. In 1991, the NPA in the banking's financial sector was more than 30%. It was successively reduced in around 2002-3 to 2%. Then, from 4 what cycle of Chidambaram and his team started and the way the bank were fleeced, then now we have such a huge NPA. So, when you are talk and the issue with regard to if the industry is saying that we do not have a competitive edge, do not have a level playing field. So, these are all legacy issues that we are trying to correct.
Gopal Agarwal, I'm sorry, but I don't know, you're mixing up two, three issues. We have a logistic problem. On the one hand, you're talking about NPA issues. Then you're talking about, you know, yes, companies not having a level playing field. Can you just clarify?
So I'm
what
talking
point
about
you're
when you are Tamanna. I'm telling you that there are several difficult problems and challenging problems in the economy created
over a period of years,
which we have tried over last 5 years to correct, and we are moving ahead. So at present there are still challenges, but that also we are meeting. But the current situation, you cannot be, we are not saying that it is a perfect economy, we have no problem in the economy. Who is claiming that?
Yeah.
We ourselves are saying that job is a challenge, we ourselves are saying that there are sectors which have lost out in the global competition, textile we have lost out to Sri Lanka, then there are issue automobile sectors, but we have sunrise sectors like pharma, we have,
you know,
sunrise
we are
sectors,
in a IT, situation,
artificial
Mr. Gopal
intelligence
Agarwal,
services
where
sector.
The telecom sector is bleeding and crying, the auto sector is bleeding and crying, real estate doesn't know what has hit them. You know, SME
power,
sector
you
is,
don't forget
is
the power
in a bad
sector.
Shape.
Don't
FMCG
forget power.
Companies are seeing
what was
a
created,
slowdown.
And even you judicial interference. Judicial
Sir,
interference,
how
power sector is a problem. So we are resolving through commercial court.
Okay, one minute. I just need some responses to some of the claims that Gopal Agarwal is making. I need some responses to some of the claims that Gopal Agarwal is making. Pooja, do you want to go first?
You know,
these are costs
the
of democracy.
And
these are costs.
One minute, sir. So you had to say.
Want to ascribe everything that is, you know, all the stress in the economy right now to either legacy issues or things beyond their control, such as the global economy. Lot of the issues are because of those reasons, but I'm afraid there is a substantial part of the pain in the economy which is a direct outcome of policy errors made by the Narendra Modi government. For instance, the scheme, Uday scheme for the power sector. Because the Uday scheme has disturbed state finances, states do not have the space to make capital expenditure, and let's not forget that the state's capital expenditure has a double multiplier effect in the economy than the center's capital expenditure does, and Uday is not done well over there. The agriculture policy, the pricing policy, the trade policy, import-export policy for agricultural commodities have shrunk. Have not allowed agriculture incomes to grow sufficiently, and that is a part of the explanation for why there is a consumption slowdown right now in the economy. Make in India has just not taken off. Manufacturing growth was much better in 2013-14 than it is today. So, you know, whereas I don't want to here suggest that, you know, the previous government made no mistakes, they made enormous mistakes.
Yeah.
And a lot of the problems that the economy is going through right now is because of the mistakes made by the previous government. But that is absolutely no reason for this government to hide behind and say that they are completely blameless.
Well,
no, they have also made policy errors and they have to own up to the responsibility
for
that.
They
can't keep blaming
others. We are taking our share of blame.
And it's only when you accept can you fix the problem?
Share of our blame.
No, it's not about blame. It's not about blame.
So who is denying? I have here only told that there are challenges in the economy which we are trying to fix. We have a roadmap. We are working on that. We have a target.
See,
we have the willpower.
Not enough perspective. Gopal Agarwal. Gopal Agarwal, just one minute. Let me put this into perspective.
I just want to make a short.
Yeah.
There will be always.
I love the fact that you can have fiery debates on the economy as well. But
I just want to make a short point.
Okay. But let's do this one by one. Let's do this one by one so that everyone can understand. Let's do this one by one. Okay.
No. Let me complete my statement.
Okay, Gopal.
Let me complete one. I'm telling you is that the economy at any point of time, economic decisions are not just black and white.
Yeah.
There will be multiple options. You choose one of the option, you allocate resources, you have limitation of resources, you allocate to one point. There can be alternative allocation which somebody may call ki it is a better, and then there can be wrong decision, right decision. If we have taken 100 decision, 3-4 decision, you may call it wrong. I am not denying, but that's in every decision this happens. So the issue is, are we committed to the growth in the economy? Growth is our target.
But those are motherhood
target.
Statements. Mr. Gopal Agarwal, those are motherhood statements. There is no government who is not committed to growth in the economy. No government comes and says, I don't want growth in the economy. I'm saying that these are serious issues. We need to go beyond motherhood statements.
So then what you want?
Sabnavis has been waiting very patiently to speak. He put his hand up. Yes, Mr. Sabnavis, and let's all listen to him, please. Yes.
Actually, I want to just give a perspective on this corporate tax collection, because in the Q2 results, we have analyzed a set of over 2,000 companies. And what we have seen is around 2/3 of these companies have actually made use of this new tax rate. So there are definitely gains which the companies have made. So we have seen the effective tax rate also come down. But one interesting point is that conversation with a set of these companies actually reveals, I don't think these companies are really looking to do any kind of investment in the near future. And I think most of them are talking in terms of repaying debt. So I think deleveraging is something which we're really talking of right now. So I don't think this corporate tax collection gain as such, so the government is going to lose, say, 1.5 lakh crores, that's what they've stated. But are we going to see a comparable level of investment taking place? The answer is probably not. Most of it is going to go in the terms of repaying debt, or probably also paying higher dividends in these taxing times.
My point. Maitli, if you can come in on this, which is my point. Great, great reform to cut corporate tax. But, you know, and where does it come from? You're doing that also in the hope to attract newer companies to India, especially in light of, you know, what's happening between US and China. But you're also hoping that this will spur investment. Private investment is at abysmal levels, Maitli. So why has the corporate tax cut not worked?
Well, yes. Well, actually, the corporate tax cut will not work miracles overnight. But as far as new companies are concerned, since the corporate tax rate is only 15%, the hope is that you will get a lot of fresh investment, particularly from overseas companies. It's too early in the day to say that it has not succeeded. But clearly, the government has made some policy mistakes, as every government does. It's easy for us to sit and criticize because hindsight is always 20-20. But the fact is that as long as the government is cognizant of the problem and takes steps, we've seen government take some steps, but they were far too hesitant. The government should have realized, woken up to the problem. It remained in denial for much too long, and now it has woken up. It might be a little bit too late, but hopefully, if the global economy revives and we see US-China trade tensions dissolve, then that would certainly help. One big plus is the fact that oil prices have not gone up.
Yeah.
God forbid, if oil prices were to go up, we'd be in a much worse phase. But hopefully, the second quarter would see the final, you know, the bottom of the trough, and after that we would look up. If you look at the Sensex, markets are often said to be prescient, forward-looking, and if we were to go by that, hopefully, we are going to see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, you know, that's an interesting point, because just yesterday on the show, this is exactly what we discussed, is the Sensex sort of divorced from the economic reality. Of course, that's a whole different discussion. I'm going to go to Pooja because she's waited patiently. She wanted to respond to what Gopal Agarwal said earlier. Yeah, just let's hear her out and then I'll come to you. Yes, Pooja.
Are you asking me, Tamanna?
Yes. Yes, you wanted to come in earlier, yes.
Yeah, you know, what I wanted to say is that for instance, Mr. Agarwal said that, you know, the government is committed to the problem of the NPAs. I just wish, you know, how is the government committed to NPAs? Is bank merger a solution for NPAs? Is the small amount of recapitalization funds that has been provided to the banks a solution for the NPAs? No, the NPAs, even if right now the ratios begin to improve, NPAs will recur. The only solution to NPAs is to privatize banks that are fit for privatization. I'm not saying privatize every bank out there, but you have to have the political will to privatize those banks that are fit for privatization at this point in time. You have to take some other difficult decisions, such as putting banks management at an arm's length. There are a whole lot of other suggestions that have been put out in many committees set up by RBI. None of those are being done.
bank merger at this point in time is not a solution to NPAs. So just being committed to solving the problems of the economy, I'm afraid, is not going to do it. A lot more needs to be done, even on the corporate tax front. Part of the problems have been resolved, but there's more that needs to be done. So we can't keep sitting on that, you know, and saying that we are committed. We need to do so much more.
No, absolutely. You know, I just want to play out one more excerpt of what the finance minister said today in her speech. Important part. Let me just play out what she said on DDT, dividend distribution tax.
Whoever brought in the mat, I know it was brought in 1987. But 10 long years, it was only aggravated rather than withdrawn. All right, sir? Again, dividend distribution tax, which even today is on, there's a lot of argument which says it's very, very regressive. 10 years that went on. But today I'm told, a lot of regressive tax, a lot of tax harassment.
All right, so she's talking about the regressive dividend distribution tax. She's talking about also a lot of regressive taxation. I just want to get a sense, and I'm going to come to Madan Sabnavis on this, on a broader question about the tax structure. I want to jog back to July this year, where the whole hue and cry started with something which we dubbed in the media as a super rich tax. Since then, that was rolled back. There have been measures to announced to, you know, push back what was called tax terrorism, anonymity, etc., streamline GST. And the focus on that was because the taxation structure was seen as a big pain point. Do you think enough has been done in that area?
Quite a bit has been done. And what they're talking in terms of DDT is probably something which will be done. And if once we have the direct tax code in, there will be probably more reforms coming in, more relief rates coming down. But ultimately, we have to see for the tax rates to work. I think we need the economy to grow. And only then will we have a situation where the government will be able to garner revenue. Otherwise, we'll have these bits and pieces of policies coming in. They'll be working at the periphery. But in terms of, and probably we will always keep saying that the government needs to do more. But I firmly believe that there are limitations to what government can do to revive an economy. And it's more left to the private sector to bring about the rest of the growth. Because if governments could have been able to do it, I think lots of countries like US, China, Japan would not have been having these kind of problems for a very long time. So I think we should not overemphasize this whole issue of lower the tax rate, the government should be doing more. I think ever since demonetization, for 3 years, we've been in a state of denial. There are structural problems which have come through. And I think it's going to be a very, very slow kind of a recovery taking place, maybe a kind of a U-shape.
The question is, if you are accepting and agreeing that DDT, you know, is passed its sell-by date, then why wait to remove it? Gopal Agarwal, I know you want to come back, but because I have to wrap, just one last thing. The reason that expectations are even higher and why the comparison with UPA 1 and UPA 2 is not necessarily the right one is because this government has a full mandate. You have nothing standing in your way. For no matter what you want to do, you have nothing, really nothing standing in your way. And you've shown that political will sticky issues which have been part of your manifesto, whether it's 370, 35A, Ram Mandir, etc. You've shown that political will there. I guess the hope is that, you know, some of that political will gets channeled to the economy as well.
Definitely, we are with a strong will. We are working on this because the Prime Minister has said that the $5 trillion economy is our target and we will achieve it. So, there is no question on that, every reform, and we are going to achieve that target. What I want to tell you is why we are stuck up only on corporate tax reduction. It is one of the steps. We have several steps that have been taken, and if for solving NPA, we are not only talking of mergers, IBC, NCLT, the NCLAT, right, and then the recapitalization of bank. All these steps have together, so why we only get stuck with only corporate tax reduction and say that this will not solve it? We are also not saying the corporate tax reduction will solve economy problem. We are decriminalizing. No, we are decriminalizing.
Because there's a lot more on the show.
No, we are decriminalizing.
On that note, I want to thank everyone just by saying that we're all in this together. economy and, you know, economic growth is something which should ideally not be in the realm of politics, because if one side loses, if it seems like the ruling party is not doing well on the economy, actually everyone suffers. So this is something that needs bipartisan support across the board. Let's get that very clear. And on that hope and an optimistic note, even though we don't know what we're going to see on Friday when the GDP Q2 numbers come, I want to thank all of you for joining us. Very short break. After the break, we're talking about Maharashtra and the news also coming in. Praful Patel has made it clear that the Maharashtra speaker will be from the Congress party, deputy speaker from the NCP, and the deputy chief minister, we don't know who yet, will also be from the NCP. But after the break, I have with me Santosh Desai. And we are going to talk about the big picture, the national impact on the Maharashtra elections. If you want to hear analysis, this is really the top person to listen to. We're also going to talk about the Ujjivan IPO and this whole rash of, you know, IPO activity going on. Are we seeing a rebound after a lull in the IPO market? All of that coming up next.